Good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church this morning. Thank you very much for being here. We are honored that you are here with us, especially if you are visiting from another church or out of town. We'll have a word about that in just a moment. We want to welcome those who are tuning in on YouTube. Thank you so much for taking advantage of that resource and staying connected with us in that way as well. Well, all you have to do is say two words, September 11th, and it has a unique meaning to each unique individual. To me, it's the difference between a patriotic holiday and a patriotic observance. This one is an observance. It's a little different. It's a little less celebratory, but I hope that through our service today, it's not completely patriotic music service. But there are some patriotic tones to it, and we hope that we will just draw you closer to the Lord and guide your prayer as you are with us during our hour of worship. And I don't even have to ask you to stand up, because the first song does it for us. Stand up for Jesus. Let's sing.
Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead, till every foe is vanquished and Christ is Lord in. Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet call obey. Forth to the mighty conflict in this his glorious day. Ye that are men now serve him against unnumbered foes. Let courage rise with danger and strength to strength. Jesus, the strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To him that overcometh, the crown of life shall be. He with the King of glory shall reign.
Singing, I was watching behind you. This is one of those Sundays where the more we sing, the more people come in the door. So let's just keep right on singing. Who is on the Lord's side?
Who is on the Lord's side? Who will serve the King? Who will be his helpers? Other lives to bring. Who will leave the world's side? The foe who is on the Lord's side, who for him will go. By thy call of mercy, by thy grace divine, we are on the Lord's side. Savior, we are thine. Not for weight of glory, not for crown and song, but for love that claimeth, lives for him who died. He who dies us nameth must be on his side. By thy love constraining, by thy grace divine, we are on the Lord's side. Savior, we are thine. Fierce may be the conflict, strong may be the foe, but the King's own army none can overthrow. Round his standard ranging, victory is secure, for his truth unchanging makes the triumph sure. Joyfully enlisting by thy grace divine, we are on the Lord's side, Savior, we are thine.
And this next one, just a grand old hymn. I'm always surprised when I look and see, wow, it has been that long since we sang this song together. Great is thy faithfulness. Lift up your voices one more time.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou
good to see you. Thank you for being here. We appreciate so much you worshiping with us. As Robert said, it is a special day. 9/11 also brings thoughts of that time, as if you were saying September the 11th. But as of that date, our country has never been the same. And some thoughts, I was sitting there thinking, you know, there's been several events in our lifetimes that some of us could say, I know where I was at when that happened. The assassination of President Kennedy, a man stepping on the moon, or 9/11. Many of us who are of the adult age could say, oh, I know exactly where. Or the explosion of the Challenger. I can tell you exactly where I was at on every one of those. Wow. Here's something else. Often it was said, we will never forget. Sad to say, many have. Many, many have. May we not forget the graciousness of God to see us through that challenging time. Churches were full during that time. And often they forgot, and off they moved. But I can tell you this, God is still in control. And that we can rely on. Heavenly Father, we do thank you. Thank you for your graciousness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for giving us a country that, Lord, we know we have faults. Oh, my goodness, we do. But what I do know is we still have the opportunity to meet on a regular basis and worship you, study the Word of God. May we not forget, not necessarily 9/11, but may we not forget what you did for us on the cross of Calvary. I'd ask now that as we move forward with our service, that you would just come upon us and allow us to have a wonderful time as we study God's word and as we also, as Robert so well put, observe the loss that our nation suffered on that day. And may we as believers not forget. And God, we thank you. Thank you for being there for us. In Jesus' most precious and holy name, amen. You may be seated. I appreciate the fact that Robert remembers these kind of days and tries to put our services around about those. If this is your very first time with us, I'm going to ask the gentleman to come on down front. That was their cue. Or your first time here at First Baptist in a really long time, if you would do us a favor, if you would get the attention of these four gentlemen who are now turning and walking towards the back, if you're near somebody who's trying to get their attention and these gentlemen don't see them, help us out. We have a card. We simply like a record of your attendance. And with that record of attendance, we're only asking that you give us your name and email address. And then we'll be in communication with you because we would like to give $10 in your honor to a local charity. And in so doing, we need that information from you. We will let you choose from a list of charities that we give to. And we would just want to honor you for being here with us. We appreciate you being here with us. And we appreciate an opportunity to serve and worship the Lord here in our area. Mike's going to come at his time, and I always enjoy hearing from our missionaries. And this particular one I've known for many, many years, and so I look forward to hearing from that missionary. Mike?
Our missionary emphasis this morning is the Thomases. The Thomases are independent Baptist missionaries or missionaries to India and are serving the Lord in Myanmar, which it was formerly known as Burma. So it says, "Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, in the beginning of 2017, with the help of our graduates, Brother Francisco Kamwa, we started planting in Shui Pai Thai." How'd I do with that? Probably wrong. Township of Rangoon, Myanmar. This is the second largest township, which is divided into 27 quarters. And he goes on to speak, and he says, "I had a full schedule for 14 of the 15 days of my visit there. Worship from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. every day, and other evangelistic outreaches. People are so eager there to listen to the gospel." Isn't that exciting? 5 out of 7 states are politically unstable and violent there. It is unsafe for a foreigner to travel. And 3 pastors came to attend the seminar, traveling 3 days one way. God has given them a burden to reach that area with the gospel. And as priorly mentioned in his other letters about open doors in Northeast India, this may help him to start ministry by the same way his parents did and began the ministry in southern India about 54 years ago. So churches are getting started. They're excited. They're able to visit some of the churches. And he has a few prayer requests for us. "Please pray for ministries in Northeast India and Myanmar." And he's asking about this because these are new ministries that they have, and they're asking for the funding that God will provide. They have an annual youth camp and a foreign contribution registration approval is ongoing. He asks us to pray for these and also pray for this project they have going on. As the last prayer letter mentioned, we are praying to purchase 2 church properties. The total amount needed is $20,000. How would you like to spend $20,000 for a church property? We have received $7,475 for this project. Please pray with us for the remaining $12,525. Your prayers are earnestly needed for our family, especially our health, financial burdens, the ministry, and government challenges. Thank you for your prayers and support. May God bless you abundantly. 4 souls in India, your missionary, Sam Thomas, and family." Let's go to the Lord and pray over this missionary. Father, we thank you for the Thomases. Thank you for the work that is continuing, following in the footsteps of his father. We pray that your hand would be upon him and his family. We pray for these needs that he's asking for his own personal health, for him and his family, the financial burdens, the government challenges, and the ministry challenges that he's facing. We also ask you to provide the finances they need for these two properties, and that your hand of blessing would be upon the ministries in Northeast India and Myanmar as well. We pray for their annual youth camp, and we pray for all these things that they're asking for. We ask you to continue to meet their needs. We pray your blessings would constantly be upon this family, for we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. The choir is now going to sing, "God Shed Your Grace on Us."
Mercy on this land. Heavenly Father, we do pray for those who lost loved ones on 9/11 over 2 decades ago. We know those families will never be the same. We pray for them. We ask you to comfort them. And for the thousands of families whose young men and women died in combat as a result of that attack, we pray for those families as well. We pray that their hearts would be healed. Lord, we pray that for our country. We pray that you would heal us and unite us. We pray for a great stir of revival in our land. And Lord, we would ask you to become real again to all of us, not just a few of us. In Christ's name, amen. Wonderful solo. I looked down at my microphone and it has 0 bars on it, which means I was going to make it through about one verse of this song and then I'd look like a country quartet as I sang on her microphone. Wasn't going to happen. This song is called Jerusalem. It's not a patriotic song, but it is a song about our prophetic future. And that's what we've been studying on Sunday mornings and Sunday nights, Jerusalem.
giants of the city.
Warriors, oh, yes, he did. John caught a glimpse of the golden throne.
Tell me all about it.
Go right on around the throne. He saw the crystal sea.
There's got to be more.
What will it be? I want to go to that city he saw.
New Jerusalem. Jerusalem.
I want to walk your streets that are golden.
And I want to run.
Thessalonians chapter number 2 is what we are studying. We're looking at Paul's admonition. Chapter 1 was his admiration for these people, and chapter 2 he admonishes them to do certain things. We began chapter 2 by looking at the greatness of the coming lie, It's found in verse 1 and 2. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by our gathering together unto him, that ye be not soon shaken in mind, or be troubled, neither by spirit, nor by word, nor by letter as from us, as that the day of Christ is at hand. The larger deception is found in verse 3 through verse 12. Last week we began looking and saw the man of sin in verse 3 through 6. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalted himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he as God sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye not that when I was with you, I told you these things? And now ye know what withholdeth, that he might be revealed in his time. And now we turn our attention to the mystery of sin in verse 7 through 12. Begin looking at the present conflict. We'll go ahead and read the whole thing, and then we won't get near all of it today. Verse 7. For the mystery of iniquity doth already work. Only he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believed not the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Heavenly Father, we ask for your help as we study your word. We know quite well that no man can teach this book. The Holy Spirit is our teacher. I pray, Lord, you'd help me as I seek to be his assistant. I pray that you would teach us from your word. Things are essential for us to know. In Christ's name, amen. The mystery of iniquity is already at work. A mystery in the scripture is a truth that was once hidden, but now is revealed. There are about a dozen such mysteries mentioned in the New Testament. They're on the screen in front of you. There's the mystery of the kingdom of heaven and the mystery of Israel's spiritual blindness and the mystery of the rapture or the removal of the church. There's the mystery of the divine will of God and the mystery of the church and the mystery of the church as the bride of Christ. And the mystery of the divine will of God. I think I got that already. Verse 7, number 7. The mystery of the indwelling of Christ, the Holy Spirit within us. The mystery of the deity of Christ. The mystery of godliness. And here, the mystery of iniquity or the mystery of sin. There's the mystery of the seven stars and the seven lampstands. And there's the mystery of Babylon. The mystery of iniquity is the secret working of lawlessness. From the beginning of time, it was the goal of Satan and his wicked spirits. We can read that in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 11 and 12, to overthrow God's purpose regarding this planet. Now, the word for work, the mystery of iniquity that's already worked, means to work actively. The word is also used to describe the active power of God's word. Paul thanked the Lord for the Thessalonians because they had received the word of God, verse chapter 2 of chapter 1 of the first book, verse 13. As it is truth, the word of God. You've received the word of God, which effectually worketh in you that believe. If you are a believer, you study the word of God, it has a work on you, and it does a work in your life. And Satan is working tirelessly to bring his plans to fruition, but he's up against a major obstacle. That obstacle is the Holy Spirit, the one who hinders and will hinder until he be taken out of the way. The word for letteth, hinders, is the same word translated withholdeth in chapter 2 and verse 6. Every weekday morning, Monday through Friday, we have a very good illustration of what this verse is talking about. As cars come in the back, they drive around and up to the front, and some will let their children off here. But in the back, right under that awning, there is something unique that takes place. We have an employee that stands out there, and they stop traffic. It's often Laura Irish. If not Laura Irish, it's Anthony DeSanto. Now, Laura does this very humbly, but Anthony is very pride-filled. I mean, he acts like he's, you know, really killing, he's holding back traffic. I go by when I got to say, protect me, especially with Laura, protect me, don't let the car hit me. By the way, I was walking by one time and someone there, church member, she claimed that her foot slipped off the brake. I think she's trying to kill me. By the way, when that lady's parked there, I don't cross. I don't care who's holding traffic back. No, she goes before I go across. I don't trust her. Without that person holding the traffic back, there would be some people that endanger the children, because there are some folk who drive faster than what they ought to in the presence of children. I mean, if there are children around and you're driving your car, your foot ought to be on the brake and you should be going very slow, because you don't know how they're going to dart out in front of you. That employee holds fast, retains the traffic, not letting them come forward lest the unthinkable take place. That restraining influence, that restraining service continues until school starts and that automatic gate closes at 2 minutes after 8. And then the traffic cannot come through anymore, and they can go off to their other place of service. They stay, and when they are removed, taken out of the way, if the gate locked open and parents were allowed to come through, some would come through pretty quickly. Now, the only one who can restrain Satan and his angels is the Holy Spirit. He is the instrument of restraint in this world. Ever since Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit empowered the church, that mystical body of Christ, Satan has been restrained. The Holy Spirit, embodied in the church, has put a stop on Satan. That stop is still in existence as we meet here today. Nothing can happen prophetically as far as what the scripture tells us until the power that is restraining Satan is removed. Only he who now hinders will hinder until he's taken out of the way. As long as the Holy Spirit is still on this earth, and the Holy Spirit lives in the members of the church, he lives within us. As long as the church is on this earth, the day of grace continues. And under grace, God will not pour out his judgments, his wrath upon this planet. And we have several biblical examples of this principle. The flood did not come until Noah was safely in the ark. The fire did not fall from heaven until Lot was safely out of Sodom. And judgment will not come until the church is removed from this planet. God is not judging his people. He will not judge us along with those who deserve the judgment. The removal of the church will clear the way for Satan and the Antichrist to take over the world, and it will happen incredibly quick. Now, although the book of Revelation gives the details, and they are dreadful, people will be left to learn for themselves what the world will be like once unrestrained wickedness is given full reign. I think we got a picture of that back in the last half of 2020. Where all over our nation there were riots, and our government did little to nothing. Buildings were burned. Businesses were destroyed. Police stations were taken over. Entire areas of downtowns were simply taken over by lawlessness, and the police were kicked out. I'll say something else here. Last week, when I prayed for the offer, I forgot where I was. And I prayed as I would be praying in my pickup truck when I'm driving alone. I pray. And I prayed for my president, and I asked God to punish him. fellow came after church and said, "How did you get away with that?" And I said, well, I said, "Forgot." I said, "What?" He said, "You know what you prayed." I said, "Well, first of all, I'd forgotten where I was." He said to me, "But don't you have Democrats that attend church here?" And I said, "Yeah." He said, "Why do they put up with you?" And I thought to myself, So I thought about it all week. About Wednesday, I think I understand why the Democrats who attend here put up with me, because they understand this is not about Democrat or Republican. It's about right and wrong. Amen. And the federal government under the Republicans in 2020 did nothing, and they were wrong too. We're not Republican, we're not Democrat. We are for righteousness. And if a Republican does nothing and lets the world become lawless, they're wrong. And if a Democrat does nothing and gets involved in wrong lawlessness, they're wrong. It's not about politics, it's about righteousness and wrong. And by the way, no matter which political party you're involved in, you should be willing to condemn your own party, not just the other. Because if you only condemn the other party, you're not sincere about that. You're not really for righteousness. You're for a political party. Neither of our presidents, none of them, have been perfect or all right. They've all are fallible human beings who make big mistakes. And as we stand for righteousness, we should be willing to point it out on every side. The removal of the church is going to clear the way for Satan and Antichrist to take over the world. If someone picked up a copy of the book of Revelation, they could figure out a lot of what would be going on. But the folks who are left here after the churches are gone have no interest in the scripture. They're not going to pick up the book. They won't know what to read anyway. They know nothing. They've already made their choices. But that does not mean no one's going to be saved. There will be people saved during the tribulation. There's anecdotal proof of it, and the scripture also just comes out and says it. First of all, there are two witnesses who come to this world, and they speak, and the entire world hears those two witnesses speak. And there are 144,000 other witnesses who are here. The purpose for a witness is to tell people about Christ. If no one could be saved in the tribulation period, why bother? But in Revelation chapter 7, we are told that there is an innumerable number of people who are underneath the altar of God in heaven. And they are crying, and their robes they're dressed in white. And when there's a question, who are these saints? Who are these people? And the answer is, there are those who died as martyrs during the tribulation period. It could be millions. We really have no idea. This group of believers will not be in the church. The church is gone, but they will be in the kingdom. And they will pay a very high price for their confession of faith. It could be millions martyred by the Antichrist in Revelation chapter 7, verse 13 through 15. It's at this point in 2 Thessalonians 2 that the Holy Spirit moves the story on toward the end by offering some details that are answered by three questions concerning the coming man of sin. And the questions are, when is he coming? And who will he be? And why? This morning we're going to look at the when question. Tonight we'll look at the who and the why question. So verse 8, when? And then shall that wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming. The Antichrist will be revealed, pretty similar to the way the Lord is revealed. He will have an apocalypse, chapter 2, verse 3. The word apocalypse means an unveiling. The book of Revelation is the revealing of Christ, and there will be a revealing of the Antichrist to the world, because the Antichrist copies Jesus Christ in everything he can. Throughout the history of the church, it has been the method of the Holy Spirit to allow evil to rise to a certain level and then send a church-born Spirit of God revival to push it back. For the past 2,000 years, this has been the history of the world. In the United States, in the 21st century, People underestimate the church for pretty good reason. The church in our country as a whole is weak, it's ineffective, it is divided by scandals, and it's now become uncertain of what it believes and afraid to stand for the truth. The problem is illustrated by a lot of church leaders who, be honest, many of them are unsaved. Many of them are just carnal. Some of them are dull or weak. You see, what the world sees today is not really a church. It sees Christendom. Jesus said that the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. But Christendom is unwilling to even advance toward the gates of hell. In the age that you and I live in, are the gates of hell being attacked? Really? A survey conducted in 2020 by the Cultural Research Center at Arizona Christian University found that 48% of American adults believe that if a person is generally good or does enough good things in their life, they will earn a place in heaven. 35% disagreed. According to that survey in 2020, about one-third of Americans believe that salvation is a gift. And over half come right out and say, no, in order to go to heaven, you got to be good. You got to live good. 52% of Americans who describe themselves as Christians now accept a works-oriented means to God's acceptance. Even those associated with churches whose official doctrine says eternal salvation comes only from embracing Christ as Savior. They went on and said 46% of Pentecostals, whose church believes, by the way, all these churches, if these churches believe that salvation is by grace through faith, 46% say works. Mainline Protestant, 44% of church members are embracing works salvation. 41% of evangelicals, 70% of Catholics hold the views that salvation is a product of works. You wonder why churches in America are weak? We have not even embraced the gospel. According to another survey by Answers in Genesis, May 30th, 2022. This is by Kim Ham's organization, Creation Museum, the Noah's Ark. This is that fella. Less than half of the pastors surveyed in the United States of America have a biblical worldview. And he gives a list of them. 47% of pastors in the United States of America have a biblical worldview regarding family and the value of life. 44% have a biblical worldview concerning issues related to God and creation and history. 43% have a biblical worldview in relation to personal faith practices, to matters of sin, salvation, and relationship with God. 40% have a biblical worldview pertaining to human character and human nature. And 40% have a biblical worldview in matters of personal lifestyle, personal behavior, and relationships. Those are the results of a survey of the men and women now in the pulpit. Churches have become entertainment centers, places for social gathering. The goal for those church leaders in churches like that is success, indicated by numerical growth. Anything that will hinder numerical growth will be avoided. For the past 2 to 3 decades, there is a whole section of churches who have been saying, stay away from doctrine. Doctrine tends to divide. Truth divides too, and doctrine is truth. On the other side, many church attenders look at church and they view choosing a church the way you choose a store to shop at. what can this church do for me? I'll give you an illustration from First Baptist Church. We've had a number of men who came to First Baptist Church and stayed for a year or two and then left. And when they left, they announced the reason that they left, because they came here looking for a wife and didn't find one. And so they go to another church looking for a wife. And I'm not kidding. Some of you are looking at me like, come on, I'm not kidding. By the way, ladies, can I give you a thumbs up? Because if a man comes to church looking for a wife, he's one to be avoided. This is not a singles place. We're not here matchmaking. You're here to worship God. Get your mind off what's the world and get your mind on the Lord. We are here to worship God, not to find you a mate. Probably made somebody mad. Well, is there a better place to find a mate than the church? No, but that's not why you're here. I found, just from my personal life watching people, people tend to find their mate about the time they quit looking. That's all you're looking for. If you just put the Lord in the right place, the Lord takes place. He takes care of things for you. Here's the problem. Without a strong, vibrant church, nations are in trouble. You remember hearing about the French Revolution? I know none of us lived through it, but in studying the French Revolution, called the Great Revolution, the streets ran red with the blood of the upper class as the citizens rebelled and practiced revenge on the nobility of France. They stormed the Bastille. They freed political prisoners. They tore down parts of Notre Dame and threw it into the streets below. The stated goal was to, quote, pull down everything that reminded of God. The arrogant Roman Catholic Church was hated as much as the arrogant aristocracy. The guillotine was at work both day and night. The nobles of France were put on farmers' carts and hauled off to meet their fate with the jeers and cheers of the people as their heads were lopped off. And during the French Revolution, just across the English Channel, was another country who was in the same shape as France. England was ripe for a revolution too. They also had a proud, privileged aristocracy and a corrupt church whose parsons disgraced the gospel. Moral conditions among the people were horrible. Crime, drunkenness, immorality reigned supreme. One would have thought that a spark from the French Revolution would have crossed the channel and ignited England too. But something else happened. A couple men, John and Charles Wesley, a revival broke out led by those men. Millions of people turned to Christ. A historian named Leckie wrote, quote, the Methodist revival saved England from bloody revolution. What saved England was not the British army or navy, because the soldiers and sailors would have sided with the insurgents because they were common folk. It was not the parliamentary reform. It was not the indecision of the common people. It was the Spirit of God who used those men and changed the nation. John Wesley preached 42,000 sermons and traveled 250,000 miles to do so. His brother Charles wrote 6,000 hymns, 4,000 of them which were popular and published and sung from one end of England to the other. The Bible message reached the heart and conscience of England. Everywhere the Wesleys went, they left behind converts by the thousands, churches filled with the message, and preachers who were there to conserve the fruit that the Wesleys had produced and spread the word and work of God. More revivals followed from the English-speaking world, went out armies of missionaries to carry the good news to other lands. Reformation followed revivals, and social conditions improved. And it started with a revival from the Word of God, and it started with a couple of men who were serious about the Word of God. Had it not been for the church in England, the French Revolution would have happened in England too. With the church gone, I'm back now, not history, I'm back to future. With the church gone, Satan and his Antichrist will be in control and will be able to run the place. In chapter 2 and verse 8, he's called that wicked one. It means the lawless one. The Antichrist will be the last in a long line of rebels. Started way back with Nimrod. By the way, the name Nimrod means rebel. Satanic type of Antichrist. Soon after the flood, Nimrod set out to build a world empire. They planned a one world society, symbolized by a common language, one world sovereignty, symbolized by the city of Babylon, a one world sanctuary, symbolized by the Tower of Babel. Are you aware that there is a whole new movement across the world trying to get us back into ecumenicalism? It's happening in churches, certainly happening in politics. The Antichrist will be revealed, but not until the removal of the church. Once the church is gone, the restraint of the Holy Spirit is gone. Then comes doom. The Antichrist will be consumed with the spirit of the mouth of the Lord, and the Lord will destroy him with the brightness of his coming. The word consume means destroy. Nothing is left. The destruction of the Antichrist will be the sole prerogative of the Christ, the very one who has so long been vilified, persecuted by people led by Satan. The Lord will come back. He will destroy the Antichrist with the spirit of his mouth. Some say it should be phrased with the breath of his mouth. Well, it makes sense. When God decided to build this planet, to build this world, he spoke and it was so. And when it comes time to tear down, he will speak and it will be so. All that the Lord has to do to destroy his enemies is speak it. In Revelation chapter 19, a sword from the Lord's mouth will slay the armies mobilized at Megiddo. What a way for John to phrase this. He speaks and his words are like a sword and he cuts down armies. Not only will the Antichrist be consumed, he will be destroyed by the brightness of his coming. The word destroy means to render inactive, to spoil, to make useless or void, or to abolish. The word is used to show how the barren fig tree is made useless. It makes useless the space that it occupies. Same word in Luke chapter 13. A tree that has no fruit is just not just useless. It's taking up land that could be used for something else. I learned a good lesson a few years back. My buddy, Buck Gaskin, had several fruit trees in his yard. And had a couple orange trees. And I was over there one day and he said, come on with me, we're going to tear a tree down. And I said, why are you taking the tree down? He said, not producing enough fruit. I'm going to get rid of it, and I'll get one that will produce fruit. I had three fruit trees in my yard, and none of them produced fruit, and I kept babying them. I water them. I put fertilizer on them. That man said, they either produce fruit or you die. You're taking up valuable land. It could be used for something else. That's the Lord's view of the Antichrist. I got to get rid of him because he's taking up space. He's causing problems. One glimpse at the brightness of his coming and all the schemes of the Antichrist will be brought to nothing. As a bright light shines into some junk-piled attic, reveals all the dust, dirt, cobwebs, crawling creatures, broken, useless odds and ends. So the brightness of the Lord's coming will reveal the tarnished tinsel, the grotesqueness, the shoddiness, the uselessness, the shame, the crime, the guilt, the sin, and the cheapness of Satan's imitation. The world will have embraced the Antichrist. And with the brightness of the Lord's coming, the world will realize they have bought a lie. It could happen any moment. It could start quickly. Heavenly Father, we see our world working its way towards the embrace of that which is unrighteous, unholy. All across our nation, that which is immoral is being embraced and worn proudly as if it were something to be honored with. Sin in our culture is no longer viewed as embarrassing. It's no longer viewed as shameful. Lord, we understand quite well, absent of a revival, this world is in trouble. This world is in trouble because the church is weak and fearful and silent and playing games in the middle of a battleground. Lord, we could pray for your return, but there are so many lost people that we instead will be praying for revival. Your return would be best for us. Revival would be best for our world. We pray that another great revival would take place. In Christ's name, amen. Robert's going to sing for us. We're going to stand. We're going to ask him to sing while you pray. We'll join him on the second verse. If God's spoken to your heart and you need to make a decision, these altars are open. Whatever you need to do, please come. Robert.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea,
we will join on the second stanza. If the Lord's spoken to your heart, you need to make a decision for Christ or to join this church or just to pray. The altars are open. Join us as we sing.
Though Satan should buffet, though
trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and hath shed his own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul.
Would you have a seat for just a moment? We've got a very important announcement. Jim, why don't you come? I did that on purpose. I waited. You're going to have a next announcement, but his is really important, he told me. She's not even going to sit down. I can't wait till tomorrow when she calls me in her office.
Real quick, our Sunshiners, which is our mature adult ministry, will be starting this coming Tuesday. We normally meet the first Tuesday of the month, But because the first Tuesday in September is right behind Labor Day, we don't choose to do that. So if you would be here, we're going to meet at 10 o'clock out of the gymnasium. We're going to have a brunch, and then we're going to come in the auditorium and tell you a little bit about what we're going to do this year. We've got a great lineup of artists, and so I want you to be a part of that. So this coming Tuesday at 10 a.m. out in the gym, bring a brunch dish and a little extra for somebody else, and then after that, we will come into here, and we'll discuss what we're going to do this year. We're excited. Our ministry has just grown over the years, and we're excited to see what God has in store for us. Also, just a few more seats left. If you are interested in going to Israel, you need to see me after the service. And now for the really, really important. See, I have to work in that office, and I want to make sure I don't get called in the office. Important announcement by Miss Diane Weatherholt.
Actually, this announcement is more from Miss Vicki. I have good news, and I have sad news. The good news is last Sunday in our 0 to 2-year-olds, we had 3 babies, and in our 3 and 4-year-olds, we had 23. That's incredible. How many of you believe that it's going to take young people to save this church, to keep us growing, and to help our country? We need young people. We all agree to that. But we need some workers on Sunday morning in the 9:30 or 10:30 service. And it's not teachers that we're looking for. The Lord has blessed us with teachers for this group. We need, as Brother Jim would say, how shall I put this? We need wranglers, you know, especially in those 3 and 4-year-olds. Because those, every once in a while, you need to say, now, little Johnny, get in your seat. Susie, put that down. You know, let's not eat our hair. Let's sit and let's listen to what Miss Mickey has to say. Or let's listen to what we hear about Jesus. We need wranglers. Now, if you're 80 years old or older, you're exempt. Okay? In fact, I'll even go if you're 75 years. But if you're 74 and under, we need wranglers. I said 74 because that includes me. I want to be a wrangler too. And I want you also to know, men are not excluded. Little children sometimes really respond well to a man saying, little Johnny, sit down. Where's Troy Conley? Is he? He's working with the kids probably. Troy Conley, who's our saxophonist husband, he is so good with the kids. When he says sit down, guess what they do? Sit down. I will say they'll do that for me, but then I tell them I'm going to jerk a knot in your tail if you don't sit down. And then they look at me, and I've always got, the Beasleys? I said that to a little boy the other day, and your son was sitting next to him. I said, tell him, Braxton, is that true? He said, oh, she's telling the truth. I will. You will obey. But we need some wranglers, guys. We need them in the 9:30 service. We need them in the 10:30 service. Now you say, well, is there anything I have to do in order to be this volunteer? Well, yes, there is, because we do want to abide by certain child safety rules. Now you can take, it's a little study. It lasts about 45 minutes. You can take it online. It's not a big deal. I talked to Miss Vicki, and we decided that if you didn't want to take it online, I don't have a computer, I don't really like to do those things, we've decided to have something fun. Next Monday night, that's September the 19th, at 7 o'clock in our media center out here, anybody who wants to take the child safety class can come. We'll have some snacks, best part ever. We're going to have some snacks, some fellowship. We'll all take the training together. Last about 45 minutes, and then you will be an approved wrangler, volunteer worker in the children's division. We need this, people. Our children need us. It's so wonderful. We've never had that kind of numbers. This is such a praise. So I'm telling you, 74 and younger, there's a sign-up sheet out in the back. So the month of October, we're not asking you to commit for a lifetime. We need help month by month. So we're asking for October. Please, please help us. And I don't really want the parents, so much of the children that are in the nursery, that's a time for them to get to come and sit and hear God's word preached from our pastor. I mean, after all, if you've had children, every once in a while you needed a break. It's those of us who maybe have survived our children, and now we need to serve. God doesn't call us to sit, soak, and sour. He calls us to serve. So that's what we're asking for. I'm going to walk down that center aisle, and Pastor, if it's all right, in honor of the late Queen Elizabeth II, can I do the Queen wave one more time? Just once. One more time. Is it
okay? I hate to make a joke about Queen Elizabeth. She just died.
No, it's in her honor.
Go ahead, in her honor. I want to see this. God save the king. Deacons, meet tonight 4 o'clock in our normal place. By the way, Mrs. Diane does have an advantage in speaking to children. When she tells them she's going to jerk a knot in their head, even if she's standing, she's still looking at them eye to eye. Robert O'Neill is dismissing us in prayer, and y'all are going to stand in honor of our prayer to the Lord.
Let's indeed join in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for blessing us here. We thank you for blessing this church. We can see your hand upon the ministries here. We thank you for the recent ones that have come to join and created these numbers in our children's ministry. We pray you would continue to work mightily. We pray that you would call people to serve there. Just speak to the hearts of those who are able and allow them to come forward and work there and just be a part of raising up the next generation in this church. We thank you for how that you've blessed our country despite our faults. We pray that you would allow us to have our eyes open and fixed directly on you. There are so many distractions and so many worldly things that can just draw us away from you. We pray that you would just draw us close and keep us focused on you and your will. We thank you so much for our pastor who speaks boldly from this pulpit. He listens for your voice as he prepares the message each and every week. And we thank you for his boldness and his leadership. Now as we go forth, just bless us with safety as we travel. Bring us back at the next appointed time. We thank you again for blessing us so richly. In Christ's name, amen.